May I ask everyone to kneel with us as we pray?
Our most precious, kind, and heavenly Father, this evening, dear Lord, we are so thankful once again that we have a chance to talk to you again every time we want to. Lord, we are inviting your presence to stand here this place as we worship you together with the angels.
Yes.
To sit with us, O Lord. Lord, we are praying for your servant, Kuya Jem, as he share the message that he will be sharing to us tonight. Lord, please baptize his tongue as he talks. And also, Lord, please fill the Holy Spirit within him so that all the words that he will be sharing will be heavenly things.
Yes, Lord.
It will help each one of us to be a spiritual person and children of yours.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, may the words that he will be sharing to us may penetrate each one of us' hearts, so that he will be used
also as an instrument to share gospel and magnify the character of Jesus Christ through us, O Lord. May the message that you will deliver us through Kuya Jem will shake us with our spiritual life, O God. Lord, we are so thankful for tonight that we will be hearing again your living testimony, O God. Please be with us throughout this service. Please forgive us, Lord, once again to the sins and shortcomings that we did. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that wonderful prayer and that wonderful message and song. Good evening, everyone. Again, I'm quite compelled to greet you. Happy Sabbath. This is like Sabbath every single night. Amen?
Amen.
I guess this is what happens when God's people come together and talk about His goodness. Every day could be Sabbath. And I just somehow have a picture of what heaven will be like. That every day, almost every day, will be Sabbath. Amen? So, today, talking about absolute reliance. You know what happened? Last night, I slept quite late. And I woke up after my alarm, I guess, was beeping for like a minute. And then I woke up at 3:30 in the morning because I know I need to catch up with some time with God. And somehow the Lord had me write down the things or copy the things that I need to speak for tonight. And today was quite a busy day. And when I went back this afternoon, I was ready finalizing the talk. And then at 3:45 in the afternoon, when I renamed my file, it disappeared. I could not find it. And I was somehow in panic. Lord, what's happening here? Do I have to go back again and do it over? And then I was praying and I was praying and I said, Lord, a life with you is a life of anxiety free. Now I'm very anxious. And then the Lord reminded me, what is our theme, Jem? Absolute reliance. I said, okay, Lord, you really wanted me to live the theme right now, so I have to rely on you. And you know what happened? The Lord changed most of the contents, and while I was sifting through the things that I was studying, the Lord gave me even more things to share. So tonight, my dear friends, this is really the message of the Lord. And when we really absolutely rely on Him, my dear friends, He will see us through.
Amen.
So tonight, before I share this beautiful message that the Lord has given us, may I like once again request our brothers and sisters to close their eyes for a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our great God, our dear loving Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to call upon your name, to speak to our Heavenly Father. And Lord, thank you that You have given us so many reasons to praise you and thank you. And Lord, tonight, again, dear Father, we come before your throne of grace, because when we are in your presence, we could never pray enough. We just want to praise you continuously. Thank you, Lord, for the praises that has been offered, the prayers that has been offered. Lord, we pray that you please continue to speak in our hearts. And tonight, dear Father, we want to hear you clearly. We want to see you clearly. And Lord, I pray that you please hide me behind the shadow of your cross, that I will not be seen nor be heard. Lord, I pray that Jesus and Jesus alone will be lifted up, magnified, and exalted. This I pray in the loving name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Tonight I'll be speaking about a very, very interesting, a very, very interesting way of the Lord's choosing. When the Lord chooses somebody, the Lord does not choose most of the time the wisest, the most talented, the gifted. He always chooses those people who thinks that they are really nothing. And even people whom he chooses that are like the chosen ones, the Lord will bring them to a point that they will feel that nothingness. And not until they feel that unworthiness, then that's the time that God can use them. And the best example, one of the best examples here was Gideon. And I guess most of you, if not all of you, knows the story of Gideon. He was asked to fight for Israel. And the Midianites during this time, I guess they are unnumbered. You could not count them. They are just so vast. And they are driving the Israelites away. And come to think of it, Gideon was chosen. And he was complaining to God, "Lord, my tribe is the weakest. And even my family is the least of all. And I am, in my family, I'm the least." So he was pleading before God. And come to think, the Lord Jesus himself appeared in front of him. But because of his distrust in self, he asked confirmation. How many times, Ron? 2-3 times? He asked confirmation. He just wants to be sure that it is God who is standing in front of him, or God that is giving him the signal to go forward. And wow, and how many did he gather? 32,000. 32,000, my dear friends. And God says, "There are too many. You have to subtract them." And the moment he says, "Whoever here is half-hearted in going in this battle, you could go home." You know how many came home? How many went home? 22,000. 22,000, and the Lord says, "There's still too many." "The people that are with thee are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands." Wow. The Midianites are almost unnumbered. And the 10,000 is still too many for God to give them the victory. You know why? Listen. "The people that are with thee are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel vaunt themselves against me, saying, mine own hand had saved me." Wow. This was the reason that God did not approve of that number. Because when the victory comes, and this is one thing, when the Lord tells you to go forward, you should be sure that there is victory. Amen? When thus saith the Lord, you know for a fact that that promise will be fulfilled. So the Lord said, subtract that. And I like Gideon's reaction. He was filled with astonishment at the declaration that his force was too large. But the Lord saw that the pride and unbelief existing in the heart of his people. My dear friend, pride and what? Pride and unbelief. Can you get this? Pride and unbelief goes together. Therefore, I conclude, those people who are prideful are those people who are scared. Are those people who are fearful. Can you make sense of this? Sometimes you might think, no, it doesn't really jive. People who are prideful are people who are fearful, people who are scared. You know why? This is the conclusion. People who are prideful, people who are thinking that they are strong in their own selves, when they are faced with a trial, they will see themselves and they will see the obstacle. They will fear. Because they will see that the obstacle is bigger than them. But people who rely absolutely on God will not see the obstacle. They will see God. Amen? Now does it make sense? So people who are prideful are the people who are fearful. So if you don't want any fear, shun away pride. If you don't want to shake in front of a challenge, in front of an obstacle, you have to pray that pride will be taken out from you. Let us proceed. Oh, and God chooses the humble instruments. And I tell you a while ago that even those who are qualified, He makes them humble until He could use them. Just imagine, my dear friends, Moses. He was trained in the best university. He was trained in AUP dental school. He was the best extractor. He was the best filler. He was the best light curer. He was the best root canaler. Just imagine this. He was the best at everything. He was at the top of his game, my dear friends. He was already honed to be the next Pharaoh. And he thinks he can carry this on his shoulders. So you know what he did? He made his own way. Let me free my people. And then he fought for his people. And know what happened? He was banished. He was banished into the wilderness. And there he learned 40 years in the school of Christ. The school of humility. And listen. And come to think of this. If you have read Exodus, and when God himself appeared in the burning bush, when he was telling Moses, now, this is the time. Now you are ready. You know why he's ready during that time? Because he does not have faith in himself anymore. He does not have any belief in himself. And during the time while I was reading Exodus, I want to choke Moses. You know why? God himself is telling him, now I'm giving you power. Now I'm giving you authority. Go and free my people. And Moses have been refusing, no, I can't do this. No, I can't do this. I don't know how to speak. Just imagine, my dear friends, the most fluent individual, the president of the class of College of Dentistry, the one who gives announcement every time, now doesn't know how to speak. He has been looking on his ability so much that he forgot that it is not because of him, that it should be God. During that time, the Lord told him, no, Moses, it will not be you. It will be me speaking through you. And this is what I've seen here. God would always put us in our place, that we will accept that we are just useless instruments being used by the all-powerful, almighty, awesome God. Amen? And listen, had Moses trusted to his own strength and wisdom and eagerly accepted the great charge, he would have proved his entire unfitness for such a work. Wow. Had Moses think that what? That it's because of his strength? He will just have proven that he is unfit for that huge work that God has given him. What was the work of Moses? The work that was given to Moses, this could not surpass any responsibility that was given to any man. You believe that? Huh? This was the greatest task that was ever given to any man, except Jesus, of course. I guess next to Jesus, Moses has the most weighty responsibility. And it says here, every responsibility that God has given us, before that, I'll ask you, whenever you are given a responsibility that is beyond your capacity, what is your reaction? No, please, I can't do that. Isn't it? Huh? No. That is not my expertise. My dear friends, in this situation, I begin to understand every responsibility or every challenge that the Lord is placing in our face, in our hands, that is your opportunity to rely on God. Did you get this? The harder the responsibility, the harder the task, the harder you'd be leaning on God. Amen? So the harder the responsibility, the more you should be praising God. Amen? Because the more obvious that God will shine through you. Okay, it says here, A man will gain power and efficiency if he accepts the responsibilities which God places upon him, and with his whole soul seeks to qualify himself to bear them aright. However humble his position or limited his ability, you get this. Listen, however humble your position, even though you're not the president, even though you're just the greeter, even though you're just the recorder of something else. It says here, that individual will attain true greatness who cheerfully responds to the call of duty and trusting to the divine strength, seeks to perform his work with fidelity. Isn't this beautiful, my dear friends? It is not because of strength. It's not because of expertise. It's because of your willingness. It's because of your availability to absolutely rely on your God. Beautiful. Every responsibility God has placed before us is an opportunity to gain power from on high. Amen. Did you get this? Every responsibility, no matter how big it is, and the bigger the better, the bigger the better, and the least you are, the more power that you will have. This is an opportunity to receive power from on high, because he's the one who promised that he will give us strength. Just imagine the strength that will be given you as you humble yourself before God. Oh, engage in such a work, the weak man will become strong. Wow. The timid, brave. The irresolute, firm, and decided. Each sees the importance of his position and his course, inasmuch as heaven has chosen him to do a special work for the King of Kings. Wow. Come to think of this. When you are chosen, you have been chosen by the King of Kings. So why should you fear? And I guess when I look back on the lives that we have been discussing yesterday, on those missionary journeys that I've encountered, on that guy, Travis Sharon, my dear friends, it is not because that he is the best guy. It's not because that he is the wisest or the most eloquent, but he gives his all to the Lord. And you could see the joy in his face. That's the result of the power that was given from on high. Amen. That is the result only for the strength that is bestowed from above. Such men, this is just beautiful. Such men will leave the world better for their having lived in it. Their influence is exerted to elevate, to purify, and to ennoble all whom they come in contact. And thus they help to prepare their fellow men for the heavenly courts. Wow. You might not even realize it, that every time you meet somebody, your presence will be a blessing to them. This is the power that only God can give. This is the influence that no man can master on himself. Only God can bestow this to you if you humbly and resolutely, absolutely rely on your God. Because, my dear friends, if we rely on ourselves, if we rely on our decision, listen to this warning. If man could foresee the result of their course, if they could realize the influence which they exert upon their own families and upon society, they would move with greater caution and would maintain a firmer reliance on God. I love this thing. Those who are determined in the strength of Jesus and make the most of their opportunity, sizing every ray of light that heaven sheds upon their pathway, will go straight forward, fulfilling their duty to God and their fellow men. They will not fall. They will not stumble. Such a wonderful promise, my dear friends. You will never fall. You will never stumble. A divine guide goes before the faithful. Wow. Encouraging them with his voice, aiding them with his hand. And they need never mistake the way. Can you say amen to this? When it is God giving you the blessing to go forward and you humbly submit before him, just imagine the divine guide goes before the faithful. It is not just you who's moving forward. The divine guide goes ahead of you, in front of you, my dear friends. In front of you, not just beside you, not just behind you, in front of you. Encouraging them with his voice, aiding them with his hand, and they never mistake the way. Just imagine this. If you absolutely rely on your God, you'll never get lost. You'll never stumble. You'll never fall. This is the promise from the Spirit of God. How can we ever doubt that? The Lord is willing. The Lord is willing to give His people a precious experience. But you know what? Just imagine this. The Lord has been willing to give us precious experience, but this is the problem. This is the problem. He would lead them to confide in His wisdom, His power, and His love instead of trusting themselves. He would want us to have experiences that are precious. But we trust so much on ourselves. We trust so much on our decisions. We trust so much, we rely so much on our dreams that we don't rely on Him. And as a result, the Lord will hold back those precious experiences. Because it says here, the wisdom of God is foolishness to the boastful and self-confident. Wow. The wisdom of God is what? Is foolishness to the boastful and self-confidence. The most complete and perfect system which man have ever derived, apart from the power and wisdom of God, will prove a failure. Wow. Did you get this? The most complete and perfect system, apart from the power of God, will prove a failure. Will prove a failure. The most perfect system that man could ever derive, apart from the power of God, it will prove a failure. But while the simple means which God sanctions must succeed, and listen, I love this, the simple act of blowing a blast upon the trumpet by the army of Joshua around Jericho. Remember? What was the act? Excuse me. What was the act that Jericho did, that Joshua did? Just walk around. Just marched around. They were commanded to march around Jericho. They did not fight. They did not throw any stone. And Jericho, man, this fortress, these are one of the strongest. These are one of the strongest walls. It's almost impregnable. But when God is the one fighting for you, nothing is impregnable. Amen? And what was the means? They just blow the trumpet. When the trumpet was blown, the walls crumbled down. The trumpet was blown and the walls crumbled down. And what did Gideon do? And by the way, we did not end the story, didn't we? From how many? From 32,000, goes down to 10,000, and now went down to 300. Yes, this is where that movie was based on, the 300. But that movie fails into comparison on the victory that was won in this Bible story. Amen? My dear friends, those 300 in the movie, they were fighters. In Gideon's story, they just brought a torch, a jar, and then they broke the jar. And then the Midianites were confused. They killed one another, and they won the victory without even shedding a blood among themselves. In the movie 300, all of them died. But in this Bible story, and by the way, this is real. This is not a novel. This is not Katang Isip. This is what happens when you rely on God. Victory would be won. The Lord can do but little for the children of men because they are so full of pride and vainglory. They exalt self, magnifying their own strength, learning, and wisdom. It is necessary for God to disappoint their hopes and frustrate their plans, that they may learn to trust in Him alone. Wow! Did you listen to that? It is necessary for God to what? Wow! To disappoint their hopes, to frustrate their plans, that they may learn to trust in Him alone. Have you ever felt any disappointment in your life? Have you ever experienced any frustration in your life? God is giving you a message. He wants you to lean on Him and lean on Him alone. Just imagine the act that God is doing just to get your attention, because he knows that this is the only safe way. He knows that this is the only safe way that you will be saved in the end if you lean hard on him, harder than you have ever leaned on him before. If blessed with a measure of success, many will become elated and self-confident and forget their dependence on God. Wow. And this is the reason why the Lord will hold back the success. The Lord will hold back the victory for in your life, because he wants you to fully depend on him. Because pride goeth before what? Destruction. And you know what? The more I read on this, the more I see that pride is a displaced faith. Did you get this? Pride is a displaced faith. The faith that should be placed or relied on God, that was placed on yourself. Did you get this? Pride is a displaced faith. And you know what? God wants his name to be glorified, not you. Not the College of Dentistry. Not AUP. But his name and his name alone be glorified. And that's why pride should be out of the picture. You know why God wants him to get the glory? Because we could not handle glory. Are you convinced with that? We could not handle glory. We don't know how to. When we receive glory, this thing here, this little thing here grows big. And when this grows big, there's no other way for you but to go down. We could not handle glory, my dear friends. Let us give God the glory. And the more we receive affirmation, the more we receive glory, you want more. You want more and more. And you know what happens? It destroys you. It destroys self. Oh, poor. And just remember, it is not because of your capacity. It's not because of you. It is because of your incapacity that the glory of God, that the miracle of God would be so obvious in your life. Amen? So when I see the requirements of God, I'm just so comforted. Oh Lord, thank you that you are not requiring tall missionaries. You're not requiring muscular missionaries, or else I would have failed. You are not requiring missionaries that have doctorate, that have dental degrees. I would not have made it. But God's requirement is so amazingly achievable. But it's hard to comply because we refuse to humble ourselves before him. We don't want ourselves to be seen as weak in the eyes of men. We cringe when they see our flaws. We cringe when they know our weaknesses. But you know what, my dear friends? Now I embrace my size. I am so happy that I'm so small. Amen. Because of this little size, God could be seen as a bigger God. Amen. Amen? In your flaws, look at your flaws and look at how God could work through those flaws. Look how God could work through those weakness. And because of that weakness, you will be reminded not to rely on yourself, but to rely fully on a powerful God who is ready and willing to give you strength to transform that weakness into the most amazing strength. And when the transformation happens, you know what happens next? They will not praise you because they know that you are incapable of doing this. All they will see is God. Amen? Amen. And you know what happens when you delight yourself in the Lord? The Lord just fills that heart with so much joy. Giving him the glory gives you so much joy. I tell you. Okay. Oh, I like this quote. I got it from the book, Living by Faith. It says here, oh, by the way, before I read this quote, I'd like you to ask yourselves this question. What is your biggest strength? Think about it right now. What is your biggest strength? Imagine that. Highlight it. Embolden it. Underline it. Place it in front of you. Write it. Okay, imagine. What is your biggest strength? Did you write it already? put a little box before it and check. Did you do it? Now you can see? I'm asking you only one. Among your strength, that's the strongest. Now listen, I'm about to destroy it. When you are strong, then you are weak. And you are weak in the very point where your strength is. This doesn't make sense, doesn't it? Again, I'll read it. When you are strong, then you are weak. And you are weak in the very point where your strength is. Why? Because you are up to pride yourself in your strong points. Oh, you look at your strength and then, wow, that's me. And listen, you have nothing but weak points. Ow! You have nothing but weak points. Whatever points that you trust in, that point is especially weak. Did you get this? Whatever point that you trust in, that you think that that is your strength, that makes you especially weak. Why? Because that strength drives you away from absolute reliance on your God. That point drives you away from fully and totally surrendering your strength to Him. And remember, we're talking about pride, we're talking about self. And come to think of it, I was pondering on this thought. Wow, remember the first temptation. What did the enemy tell Eve? What did the enemy tell Eve? You shall not surely die. And then the next one, you shall be like what? You shall be like gods. You. And pride, you know what pride is? Putting your faith on yourself rather than God. Pride is like the violation of the first commandment. What was the first commandment? Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. And the temptation was, you shall be like what? You shall be like gods. And the first requirement was, thou shalt not have no other gods before me. When you take pride on something, you place that worship on yourself. You place that worship on yourself. Having pride is a violation of the first commandment. Wow, it's mind-blowing, isn't it? We don't even realize that we're breaking the law of God in worshiping our own strength, in worshiping our own selves. It is not the man whom the world honors as great, talented, or brilliant that God selects. He chooses those who will work in meekness and simplicity. Wow. Acknowledging Him as their leader and their source of strength, He would have us make Him our protector, our guide in all duties and affairs of life. In how many duties? In all duties and affairs of life. He would have us make Him our guide, our protector. Come to think of it, God is offering Himself to us. I will be your guide. Jem, if you go around a mission trip, I will be your tour guide. I will be your travel agent. I will be your protector. How can you say no to that? How can you resist that? Because the Lord designed to show His people that He was the source of their strength. And you know what the first plan that God has? That Israelites, they should have no king. They should have no king, that God Himself will be their king. Remember when they got out of Egypt, when they crossed the Red Sea, who fought for them? Did they fight the chariots of the Egyptians? No! God fought for them. They are weak. They don't know how to fight. All they know is domestic duties, construction work. They were not trained to fight. And God wants Himself to be their king. Jesus Himself wanted to be their king. But they rejected Him. They impeached Him by putting up a king, a human king in front of them. Did you get this? By choosing a human king in front of them, they impeached the Son of God. as their king. They impeached Jesus as their king. And this is one beautiful thing. Because you know what? If we fully, truly rely on the Lord, He will really direct our paths. I always bring this devotional verse in the girls' dorms every morning when I go around. I love this verse in Psalm 32 verse 8, which says, I will teach thee and instruct thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. Just imagine this. If God is the one who's guiding and teaching you in the way that you shall go, how could you get lost? And another reading here. And by the way, I'm reading this from the Signs of the Times about Gideon. This thing really blew my mind. It says here, the Lord Himself directed Gideon's mind in the adoption of a plan which the latter immediately set out to execute. The Lord Himself, what? Directed Gideon's mind. Who is directing our minds, my dear friends? Are we listening to God's direction? You know, when I read this, I read the possibility of being led and guided and directed by God in every single aspect of our lives. Isn't this amazing? Isn't this wonderful? I'd like to share with you, I guess this testimony has been shared more than 100 times already, when I got my visa. I will not share the whole thing, but just on that visa type of thing. You know, I don't have to explain for some Filipinos, but for some foreigners here, getting a U.S. visa for a Filipino is not easy. You just have to go through a small needle. And I'm thinking, Lord, how could I be given a visa when I don't even have a bank account, when I don't even have an employer? Oh, by the way, when I decided to be a missionary, I decided by God's grace that I will not receive any salary. I will absolutely rely on Him. And the Lord has been faithful for the past 5 years and a half. He has been faithful. So 2013, I applied for a U.S. visa. And before applying, I look at the date. My application is on January 10. And my class begins in Amazing Facts in the U.S. January 24, 2 weeks. And I said, Lord, if you want me to go, you really have to move mountains here. And the moment I paid that amount for registration, for visa fee, I could not sleep, my dear friends. I'm not the kind of person who has trouble sleeping. I tell you, I have the gift of public sleeping. I could sleep anywhere. I sleep even in terminals, and I praise God for my petite size, that I will just hug my backpack and just in a few minutes, I will growl. And even inside the LRT, standing up, I'm sleeping. And I like the LRT in the Philippines. You don't have to have your bag being held. You just lift it up, it stays there. And people just pass by. They go in and out. I sleep like... I could sleep anywhere, but the moment I applied for this U.S. visa, my dear friends, I could not sleep. Because a year before that, 2012, my friend asked me to go to New Zealand. That was a very quick invitation. And when I applied, I got denied. So every time I sleep during that night, I had this nightmare. Every time I close my eyes in a few... And by the way, I don't know what's happening with this mind of mine. Like 5 minutes into sleep, I'm dreaming already. Some people, it will take them like an hour, and that's the time that they dream. Just like 2 minutes, I'm already dreaming. And every time I go to sleep, there is this nightmare. Denied! Denied! And I get up from my sleep, and like for 5-7 straight days, I could not get enough sleep. And my dear friends, I'm telling God, Lord, what's wrong here? I'm already losing weight. My dear friends, I'm not the kind of person that has the right to lose some more weight. So I came to the Lord. I frustrated myself to the Lord. Said, Lord, please help me out. And this is one great thing, my dear friends. The more we feel our need of God, and I use my necktie, I went there. I thought I came prepared. But the moment I sat down, my dear friends, I could not breathe. I'm not joking. It was really terrible. It's like all my insides are clamoring to come out. And my heart was beating so loud that I could not hear myself think. And my dear friends, this is just scary because I watched so many cartoons before that I was imagining that my heart was literally pumping out of my chest. So I keep on looking down. I said, Lord, please help me out here. And I said, Lord, I could not be interviewed like this. I don't want to be interviewed like, I could not imagine like, what is your name? My name is Jem Katso. You fall to the ground. I said, Lord, please. And then you know what? The Lord compelled me to go look for a place to pray. So I went to the bathroom, I went to the toilet, closed the toilet cubicle, knelt down, closed the toilet seat, and then there I prayed. And this is one thing that I have learned, my dear friends. If you seek God with all your heart, He will not hold back His blessings from you. I said, Lord, I need You. I need that peace, that passive understanding that You have given me during that night. And the Lord gave it. And this is one thing that I have learned as well. If you seek God with all your heart, any place in this world will be transformed into a prayer room. When I came out of the toilet, I was already smiling. I had so much peace. And now the interview came. Excuse me, sir? Yes, sir, Mr. Castor. How much is your monthly income? I said, patay. And I did not say patay, but I'm just saying it in my mind. I said, oh, Lord. First question. And the Lord just compelled me, be honest. You're a missionary. You should not lie. So I said, I'm sorry, sir, but I don't have any monthly income. Why is that? I'm a missionary volunteer, sir, so I don't get paid for my work. Then how do you live? I live by faith, sir. Good for you, you laugh. He did not laugh. So he just said, I live by faith too, but tell me, how do you really live? How do you buy your food? How do you buy your clothes? And I said, the Lord provides, sir. And then this person who's interviewing me, he thought that I was joking. He thought that I was not taking him seriously. So he's getting more irritated every time he sees me, every time he hears my answers. So, and he took out my passport. And by the way, the only document that I brought was my passport. And then he looked at my passport and he says, if you are not paid for your work, how come you travel so much? And I said, sir, I'm involved in the prayer ministry. So I pray to the Lord and the Lord uses other people to pay for my fare. And I said, so, okay. That's acceptable. But how about your hotel? How about your food? How will you able to survive outside of the Philippines? It's expensive to travel outside of the Philippines. How are you able to survive without any salary? And I said, sir, I live in their homes and they feed me. Which is true. Right now, COD is feeding me. So, and then he looked and he's running out of question. I pity the guy. And then later on, he's thinking deeply, and then he remembered one question. Said, how about emergencies? Do you encounter emergencies? And I said, yes, sir, emergencies are unavoidable. Then how are you able to pay for emergencies? I said, sir, the Lord is faithful that the Lord provides the right amount of money for the right amount of emergencies. Then you're telling me that you receive money for emergencies? And I said, yes, sir, God is faithful. Then you just lied to me. I said, oh, how come, sir? I said, because a while ago, you're telling me that you don't receive any amount of money for your work. And now you're telling me that you receive money for emergencies. That is a difficult question to answer, my dear friends. Isn't it? And remember my condition a while ago? If I was in that condition, I would just... I would have just received a death certificate rather than a US visa. So... you know what? But God is amazing. And this promise that I read a while ago, this brought me to this scene right now. The Lord Himself directed Gideon's mind. And God directed my mind during that time. I could not have come up with an answer. That is a difficult question. And remember the kabog-kabog that I was feeling. My dear friends, I would have just fallen dead. But before he even finished the question, I had the answer. And I told him, sir, a while ago you're asking for a regular monthly income, but emergencies, sir, are not regular. That is a smart answer. Ah. And I'm not that smart. I'm not joking here. I'm not that smart, and I know I could not have come up with that answer in 100 years. And then he was having when I said that, I was even amazed that I uttered those words. Like deep inside, I was having this expression like, this is one thing that happens, my dear friends. When God works the frail instruments, you will just be amazed of what God can do. You will just be blown away that God could use something that is nothing and make something beautiful out of it. And when those things are happening before me, I was just like sitting, wow, Lord, this is awesome. I'm not saying, I'm awesome. No, you know for a fact that you are useless, that you could have just died during that interview. But God is the one who's fighting for you, who's giving you those words. And after I said those words, I could see the distress in his face. Now he's even more problematic, and I pity him. So I told him, sir, from the very beginning, I really wanted to be honest with you. I wanted to come clean. I don't want to give you a salary range that I don't earn. I don't want to give you a bank account that I don't have. Sir, I don't have any bank account. I don't have any salary. I have been living by faith for the past two years during the time. And then he looked at me. And then he gave a big sigh. Then tell me, how should I feel in this section? Monthly income. My dear friends, we are still in question number one. And then I told him, honestly speaking, sir, I don't know. Says, okay, monthly income. Not applicable. And then a few more questions. And then he told me, congratulations, your application has been approved. And then I said, what? I could not believe what I was hearing. And then he says, your visa will be mailed to you in 5 working days. I said, oh, thank you, sir. And I got out of that embassy and I was crying. I was calling my sister and I said to my sister, sis, I got my visa approved. And she was crying on the other line. Said, surely God was with you. God really wants you to go. You know what, my dear friends, before I even stood up, God wants his signature in each and every life that is listening to his voice right now. He wants a signature in your life. He wants to do something great in your life. Only if you have an absolute reliance upon this powerful God, upon this beautiful God. I like this quote. I'd like to read this to you. It says, men can accomplish what? Nothing. I read that to you the first day. Men can accomplish what? How much? Nothing. It's like you're not convinced. How much?
Nothing.
Say it with more conviction.
Nothing.
That's too weak. Say it with more conviction.
Nothing.
Amen. Nothing. We have to repeat that again and again so that we will believe that. Because most of the time we are not convinced that we can do nothing without God. In reality, my dear friends, you could never do, and you could not do anything without God. Only by God's grace that we could do something. But with God, we could do everything. Amen? And it says here, oh, beautiful. And God has arranged his plan so as to accomplish nothing in the restoration of the human race without the cooperation with the human and the divine. The part man is required to sustain is immeasurably small. How much more? Immeasurably small. I like this quote because I'm small. Yet, in the plan of God, it is just that part that is needed to make the work a success. Wow. Yet in the plan of God, it is just that part that is needed to make the work a success. My dear friends, the Lord has been waiting to do so many successful things through you, so many precious things through you. All you have to do is see your incapacity and run to Him. Absolutely rely on Him. rely on Him, and He will make you a wonderful instrument. It is not because of your strength, my dear friends. It is because of your strength that you focus on that God could not work in your life. But it's because that you have seen that you are nothing without God. Do not delay God's power in your life. Do not delay God's wonderful miracle happening in your life. Stop living a boring life, my dear friends. Stop living a very calculated life. Start living a life that only heaven can calculate. Only heaven can direct. Only heaven can predict. And that life is available for each and every one of you. This is no coincidence that you are here in AUP. And this is no coincidence right now that you are here Thursday night in COD Week of Prayer. The Lord brought you here. Amen. It's not just the attendance that you are here. The Lord brought you here. When the Lord planned, when the Lord created the world, He already had the COD Week of Prayer in mind. And He already had you planned sitting there where you are right now. And the question right now is, will you respond to Him? Will you say, Lord, in my weakness, I will come and I will rely fully upon You. If you want to tell Him that, I'm asking you, stand on your feet and come forward. You say, Lord, yes, I'm weak right now, but I give You my weakness. Use this weakness to destroy footholds of the enemy. Come as close as possible. Come as close as possible. And while Miriam will sing a song, those who want to come, come as near as possible. Don't hold back.
Lord, I call it now.
such a powerful song, such an evidence of the Lord's leading. Didn't you know that me and Miriam did not even talk what topic? It is all God who led this. And this is just an evidence that God has planned all of this. God has planned with you in mind, because He wants you to be in His kingdom. He needs you to be there. Heaven would not be as joyful if God loses a child. So my dear friends, let us come as close as possible as we kneel down. And I know that we have a lot of things that we want to say to the Lord in our hearts. And whatever it is, whether it be a praise, whether it be a confession, whether it be a prayer request, we ask you to lift it up. Lift it up so that we could agree to your prayers as we pray unitedly. One sentence prayer. Would you like to lift up to the Lord? Let us bow our heads. Take my life and make it yours, Lord. Father, as we begin to lift to you the prayers that you will compose in our hearts, I pray, dear Father, that you please speak through each one of us. Amen, Lord. Amen. Amen, Lord.
Yes, dear Heavenly Father, we can truly see that you are faithful, but who are we, dear God, that you should be faithful to us?
Amen.
We praise you, dear God, for you are faithful even though who we are, dear God.
Yes, Lord, amen. Lord, please. Amen, Lord. Please forgive us, dear Father, for relying on our own strength and not relying on you.
Father, forgive us, for we are like Moses. When you give us responsibility, we immediately say no because we look at our strength.
Yes, Lord.
Forgive us, Father, and help us, Lord, to absolutely rely on you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Heavenly Father, forgive us if we have thought that this life is about us, and we praise you, Father, for this life that you have given us is always about you.
Amen, Lord. Lord, please take a hold of our hearts. Yes. Never let us go.
Father, you have told me today that a rebellious heart cannot be cured. Father, let not anyone here, Father, stand up today without a new heart, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Father, thank you for bringing disappointments in our lives.
Yes, Lord, amen.
Father, that indeed without you we are nothing.
Amen, Lord.
And you are the only source of strength in our lives.
Amen, Lord.
Our Almighty God, we pray for the purification of our heart and keep every defect in our character.
Yes.
We may be acceptable into your kingdom.
Amen, Lord.
Father, we praise you for magnifying our weaknesses so that your strength will be magnified.
Amen, Lord. Father, we pray that you will remove every bit of ourself and let Jesus be in.
Amen, Lord.
Father God, thank you so much that seeing our weakness and experiencing disappointment is not the end of the world.
Amen.
But a new beginning, because you are the God of new beginnings.
Amen, Lord.
Yes, Heavenly Father, if you have to, Lord, make us experience nothingness and relying on self.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
Father, sorry for the achievements we have not made. Yeah. We did not allow your Holy Spirit to
yes.
empower
us. Yes, Lord.
That self, Lord, got in the way.
Yes.
The work you want us to
do. Yes, Lord.
Yes, dear God, agree with my brother's prayer. Forgive us, Lord, for missing the opportunity that you have revealed your power in the past.
Yes, Lord.
Father, forgive us for our timidity.
Yes, Lord. Yes, dear Father, forgive us that sometimes we are ashamed to be called your sons and daughters.
Yes, Lord. Yes, come, Lord Jesus, into our lives, Lord, and let your signature be in every aspect.
Yes, Lord, amen.
Father God Almighty, you shall call upon the name of the Lord, and you shall save us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Father, forgive us for the times we have led many others astray.
Yes, Lord.
We should have led them by our words, actions. And Lord, even the way we think of selfish thoughts that we don't realize.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we lead others people.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
Oh, dear Heavenly Father, to think about it, how many people have gone astray because of our example
yes,
and because
yes,
of
Lord.
Our consecrated hearts.
Yes, Lord.
Will you please, dear Heavenly Father, forgive us and give us another chance to do what you want us to do.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Thank you, God, that you care for our own salvation.
Yes.
You care for our own.
Yes, Lord.
Father, open our eyes, O God, to see the dangers in the world.
Yes, Lord.
So that we may rely fully on
you, O God. Yes, Lord. Yes, dear Father, I agree with my brother's prayer and open our eyes that we will see your beauty. Amen. We will see your character. We will see your goodness, Lord.
For the times we have neglected prayer.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we have relied upon ourselves.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
Oh, dear Father, take a hold of our hearts the way that you have never held us before.
Amen.
Give us the strength to hang on to you.
Yes,
give us, dear Father, the resilience to wrestle the way Jacob wrestled with you. Oh, dear Father, may our prayers always be, I will not let thee go unless you bless
Amen.
Us.
Yes,
Lord, please be with us as we sing our closing song. Take my life and make it yours, Lord. Fill me with your love. Take my life and make it yours, Lord. Fill me with your love. You are all I need. I surrender all of me. Yes, dear Father, you are all that we need. And we surrender, all of us, dear Father. We surrender our hearts. We surrender our dreams to you. We surrender our strength that had been our biggest weakness. Lord, we surrender our strength, dear Father, that had been a hindrance for you to use us for the glory of your name. Whatever is hindering us, dear Father, to come closer to you, Lord, I pray that you please pluck it out. Yank it out of our lives, dear God, that nothing could come between us. Oh, dear Father, I pray that we will never forget that we are in the midst of the great controversy, that we are in the midst of this battle. But help us never, ever to forget as well that we are on the winning side when we are on your side. Yes. Thank you so much, Lord, because we know that we serve a wonderful God, an amazing God, a powerful God, a loving God. Lord, be with us. Lord, I pray that you please saturate our lives with your Spirit. Lord, I pray that you please baptize each and every person who is knelt before you right now. Soak us, Lord, with the power of the Holy Spirit from the tips of our hair to the soles of our feet. Lord, please help us that we will overflow with your presence.
Amen.
Help us, Lord, once again, we pray this, that in our devotions, in our time with you, help us, Lord, never to let you go unless we are so filled with your Spirit. Help us, Lord, that when we go out of our personal time with you, help us never, ever to leave your presence until our faces will shine.
Amen.
Lord, we pray that when we leave this place, that when COD, week of prayer, is over, that our walk with you will just begin. It will never be over.
Amen.
Lord, I pray that you please walk with us. We could not do this on our own. We are weak, but you are strong.
Amen.
Walk with us closer than you have walked with us before. Lord, thank you once again for your promise that we could draw as near as possible to you, that there's no limit of how close that we can be.
Amen.
Make us so close, dear Father, that when we walk, we will not be seen.
Amen.
That it will just be one person walking. Lord, thank you so much, dear Father, for hearing us. Thank you, Lord, for protecting us from bad weather, from the rain, from all the elements. We could feel your presence in this place. We could feel the Holy Spirit's presence in this place. And Lord, we pray that you please help us not to allow anything that will drive away the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Lord, as we leave this place, help us, dear Father, to pray with each one. Never ever to be content of what we have here. Help us, Lord, to pray everywhere that you compel us to do it, whether it be in the hallways, whether in the field, whether in the sidewalk, dear God. Father, we need you.
Amen.
We need you badly. Thank you so much, Lord, because you have said that a soul that realizes its need, nothing is withheld.
Amen.
So thank you so much, Lord, for not holding back your power. Thank you so much for not holding back your Spirit. Thank you so much for not holding back your presence.
Amen.
We give you praise and we give you thanks. And we love you, Lord.
Yes.
This we pray in the loving name of your Son, Jesus. All your children say.
Amen.
Good night, everyone. See you at 6 p.m. tomorrow.